sharp relief, the obvious is I think worthwhile. Just a few very basic concepts I want to go over and then their applications. The idea of isotopic masses, isotopic abundances, and a little bit on high resolution mass spectrometry in mass spec. The technique we're talking about last time, we were talking about literally separating your molecules, molecule by molecule, based on the mass to charge ratio. In other words, you have different isotopers, but you're actually separating each isotopomer from each isotopomer. So we're going to look at some of the implications of this concept. Really, you know, there are sort of three concepts in mass spec, and really only the last of them is profound in any sort of way, in the sense that everything else really, although I'm not saying it, one won't make mistakes or have problems occasionally, are things that a high school chemistry student could handle. The idea of exact mass, isotopic abundances, these are the areas where misunderstanding occurs. The only area that really involves sort of a graduate or even sophomore, but often graduate level understanding, is fragmentation. And we're going to reserve that, at least in EI mass spec, we're going to reserve that for our very last lecture. We'll talk about things. If I have a chance, I'll show you one example in a soft ionization technique. So the basic idea in high-res mass spec is that better instruments and better calibration can give you your mass beyond unit mass. They can give you with precisions up to, say, 5 parts per million. So I'll say better instrumentation and better calibration and by calibration I'll often mean using an internal standard, a compound with a known mass, often with a mass defect, the difference from unit mass, so it falls just below unit masses, so it keeps out of the way and can be identified. And then one can calibrate and linearize your mass spec scale. Can give you masses or mass to charge ratios with a high precision. Just to bring the obvious into sharp relief, what does that mean? This isn't, of course, parts per million as you have in the NMR scale. It means if I were to have a compound with the mass of 300.00000, to my knowledge, there's no such compound, but if I had such a hypothetical compound, then plus or minus 5 parts per million would mean an error of plus or minus 0.0015, or what mass spectrometrists would often say, 1.5 millimass units, MMU. Now, the key idea then is that the molecular weight that we're going to be determined, or the M to Z, is going to be dictated by the atomic weights of the isotopes present. Something that we forget about when you go into the lab to measure out a millimole of a compound with molecular weight 158. When you go into the lab to measure millimole of a compound with molecular weight, let's say 158.04, and you're aiming to weigh out 158.04 or 158.0 milligrams of the compound, that's based on the atomic weight of carbon. And so if I go and I look at carbon and its atomic weight, I would see 12.011, and if I want to take it to a couple of more digits, 15. So I'd plug that in. If I had a C12 compound, I'd say, all right, 12 times 12.00115 is the contribution of carbon. But if you're separating molecule by molecule, then you're going to be concerned with the carbon 12 isotopomers. Carbon is 98.9% carbon 12 and 1.1% carbon 13. And so this atomic weight represents an average. Carbon 12 has, as I said, it's 98.9% abundance, and its mass, by definition, this is how we define the scale of masses, is 12.0 as many zeros as you care to write down. Carbon 13 is 1.1% of naturally occurring carbon, and its mass is 13.00336. So this number here represents a weighted average of the 98.9% C12 and 1.1% C13 present. I'm going to jot down a few more masses. We'll use them in a moment. These are also present in one of the tables in your book, Table 1.4 in Silverstein. But I think it's worth, at least, as I said, bringing in the sharp relief some of the obvious here, and also we're going to use these numbers in just a moment. So if I go to my periodic table and I look at the atomic weight of hydrogen, we get 1.00794. But again, hydrogen is a mixture of predominantly protium, H1, as well as a little bit of deuterium. It's about 1 part in 7,000 deuterium, or if I want percentages, 99.84% protium, and its mass is going to be 1.00783. And I'll just point out, I'm not going to write the masses for all of the other isotopomers, but I'll just remind us that it's a very, very small amount of deuterium, just 0.016% of deuterium. Organic chemists have a relatively small repertoire of elements. I'm not going to write them all out here, although we'll come back when we're talking about isotope patterns. But I'm just going to write out a couple more. CHNO, nitrogen, atomic weight is 14.0067, and nitrogen comprises a mixture of 99.62% nitrogen 14, and also nitrogen 15.038%. And it's interesting, when we come to NMR spectroscopy, we'll talk about carbon NMR, that's relying on the C13 present, because carbon 12 is spin inactive. One can also do nitrogen 15 NMR. Nitrogen 14 has a quadrupole and doesn't show up in the NMR. And there's just so little N15 at natural abundance that it's teasing. It's very hard to get a spectrum of N15, but in some cases, say an alkaloid synthesis, it actually can be very useful. All right, so anyway, for N14, the exact mass, the atomic mass, is 14.30 7. And I'll just point out for oxygen, you go to your periodic table, the atomic weight for oxygen is 15.9994. Oxygen comprises oxygen 16, which is 99.76%, as well as oxygen 17, which is 0.04%, and oxygen 18, which is 0.20%. And the exact mass of oxygen is 15.99491. So again, to state the obvious, if you're calculating molecular weights, you're going to be using 12.0115, 14.0067, 15.9994, and 1.00794 to weigh out your compound. But for mass spec, you're going to be using 12.010, 14.00307, 14.99491, and 1.00783. All right. Now, what are the implications of having different masses? Now, the reason you have different masses, right, you'd first say, well, wait a second, why is this the case? You'd say oxygen 16 is 8 protons, 8 neutrons. Carbon 12 is 6 protons, 6 neutrons. They should have proportional weight. In other words, oxygen 16 should be 16.0000. Why isn't it? And, okay. Exactly. So we can blame Albert Einstein and the physicists for this one. The fact that the energy, literally, of combining protons and neutrons is different, and hence the mass is different in the case of carbon 12 and 16. All right. If one is using a high resolution instrument, one can determine molecular formula on small molecules, or to put it more specifically, find a molecular formula that fits. Let's take a very simple example. So I'm going to take propane, CH3, CH2, CH3, and acetaldehyde, CH3, CHO. Now both of these nominally have a molecular weight 44. But with a high-resolution instrument, one could tell them apart, and conversely, if one measured a high-resolution measurement, one could distinguish and say, this mass is consistent with acetaldehyde, it's not consistent with propane, and furthermore, with small enough molecules, you could say this molecule, this mass is not within, say, limits of 5 ppm, consistent with any other masses, or this is the best fit. Here are some other fits that don't fit as well or don't comprise reasonable formulae, like they contain, you know, 5 nitrogens and 1 carbon. All right, so if I take propane, C3H8, I'm going to take C12H8H18, and I'll just, for the sake of, again, bringing things into sharp relief, remind us that then what we're going to do is take 3 times 12.000 for as many zeros as you like, plus 8 times 1.00783. And that number I get, and I've of course worked it out before, is 44.06. 2.6. If I do the same thing for acetaldehyde, I'm going to be taking 2 C12s, 4 H1s, and 1 O16, and And now I work this out in exactly the same way, 2 times 12.0000 plus 8 times 1.007 plus 4 times 1.00783 plus 15.99491. And the sum in total that I get over there is 44.0262. And so we have a difference here, I'll write this as delta, of 36.4 millimass units, or MMU. So a computer can easily give you a fit that basically says, okay, we measured a number. You might measure a number that's slightly off from this. You might, for example, measure the experimental value. It might be 44.0258. And a computer would be able to easily give you all masses that fit if you told it this molecule can contain up to so many carbons, up to so many hydrogens, up to so many oxygens, nitrogens, and et cetera. And in fact, and on your homework, I've given you some exercises with a couple of calculators here that allow you to do these same calculations. You also can do these types of calculations, although not the fit. You do the basically this as a trivial calculation in ChemDraw. But it doesn't surprise me the first time I see a first-year graduate student in the summer using the molecular weight instead of the exact mass in analyzing his or her mass spec. So again, I'm just sort of bringing the obvious into sharp relief. Any questions or thoughts at this time?
What is it nitrogen have a reduced mass? If you say oxygen has a reduced mass.
A lower. Why does the nitrogen?
Yeah.
So, all right, if you go to E equals MC squared and you imagine banging together protons and neutrons, I guess what we're saying is that the energy that holds them together is going to be greater in the case of oxygen than in the case of nitrogen. In other words, that in the case of bringing seven neutrons and seven protons together, you release less energy than in the case of bringing eight protons and eight neutrons together. Does that make sense? In other words, literally, when you have, well, I mean, it happens in a chemical reaction, but to a scale that's completely unmeasurably small. But in a nuclear reaction, if you imagine bringing together or combining nuclei, you're releasing so much energy, the energy holding them together now ends up making your mass larger.
I just thought it'd be linear.
Ah, but all nuclei are not held together with the same strength, which is why some are radioactive. And so I would surmise that tritium would be a little less stable and would probably be a little more than, you know, a little more than three, but a little more than you would expect. Other questions?
I was just saying, isn't it true also that a proton and neutron, like, they roughly want to call it mass units, but they're not?
They're not exactly. And then, of course, we have some electrons in there that have a very small mass. And by the way, we typically, although we're going to be talking about ionizing by kicking out an electron in the EI mass spec or adding a proton in the CI mass spec, we're typically not going to worry about the weight of that one electron. In other words, that one electron has some trivial mass that's probably right out either here or here. But we're not gonna worry about that one electron in calculating our exact masses.
I have a question about when you're doing these calculations. When you are, I don't know,
So this came up on bromine last night on one of the homework sets. Since we're separating ion by ion, you're going to be putting in the lower exact mass. So for bromine, you will put in the exact mass of bromine 79. And we typically call, when you get, and I want to get into isotope patterns right now, but typically when you have isotope patterns, even if the first peak is not the biggest peak, we call that peak M. So we usually look at that. And we then basically count that one, and then the higher, so if you're reporting, say, for a paper, and you have a compound with 110 carbons, so that the M plus one peak is the biggest peak in the cluster. I'll show you in a moment if you're familiar with this. But you would typically still report the first peak in the series of isotopes. Other questions? Let's take a look at some isotopes right now. And I'm going to do this all with drawings on the blackboard, because the point is getting it into our head, not getting a representation. If you look in your book for representations, good representations. All right, so if this is the EI mass spectrum of methane, CH4, you would expect to see, and now we're forgetting about high resolution, so we're only talking about unit mass. We can come back to high resolution in a moment. You'd expect to see one peak at 16, and you'd expect to see a second peak at 17, and that second peak would be 1.1% of the height of the first peak. The first peak, of course, would be the C12 isotopomer. The second peak would be the C13 isotopomer. And with typical resolutions, any of the minuscule amount of deuterium isotopomers would essentially fall right on top of this peak and would not typically dissolve. And of course, we get this ratio because you have 1%. Now, if we go to something like ethane, and again, I'll be giving you representations of the EI mass spec. We'll come to CI mass spec and ESI mass spec in a moment. But if I go ahead and give you a spectrum of C13, now you'd see a peak at 30 and a peak at 31. And by the way, we call this peak M plus, and we call this peak M plus 1. And similarly here, we see call this peak M plus, and this peak M plus 1. And now your M plus 1 peak would be about 2.2% in height. 2.2% simply represents the statistics of having two C13s in the molecule. In other words, the probability of two C13s is essentially 2 × 1.1%. It's not exactly that number, because there's also a probability of having two C13s in the molecule. The probability of having two C13s, whoops, did I say two? I meant the probability of one C13. The probability of two C13s is 1.1% of 1.1% which is 0.0012%. So the point is, in any real mass spectrum of a teeny tiny molecule like ethane, you're going to have a minuscule M plus 2 peak. And this becomes becomes important when we get to elements like sulfur and silicon that have a significant amount of M plus 2 isotopomer, not to even mention elements like chlorine and bromine, and we'll discuss all of those in just a second. So let's take a look at other common elements with isotopes. Ones that are common to organic chemists. So I've already mentioned that N14 and N15 coexist together naturally. The ratio is 100 to 0.38. What that means is for any small organic molecule, the contribution of nitrogen to the M plus 1 peak, of N15 to the M plus 1 peak, is going to be small but finite, and you're not going to see any significant, with a small molecule, any significant N plus 2 peaks from having, you know, two or three or four N15s in your molecule. O16, as I said before, is the predominant isotope of oxygen along with O17 and O18. Just taking these percentages and turning them into ratios, it's 100 to 0.04 to 0.02. This number is so small, the amount of O18, that for any small molecule with just a few oxygens in there, the contribution to M plus 2 is going to be very, very small. If you have 10 oxygens in a molecule, which would be a relatively heavily oxygenated molecule, like a sugar or some other highly oxidized compound, polyol, for example, you would expect in the mass spectrum only, say, a 2% contribution. In other words, it wouldn't stand out and stare at you. However, when you get to certain other elements, they become rather prominent. So, for example, silicon has isotopes 28, 29, and 30, and the ratio of them is 100 to 5.10 to 3.35. So the point being that now, when you have a compound with, say, a silicon protecting group in it, you would expect in the mass spec to have a small but noticeable M plus 2 peak. In short, your mass spectrum would be telling you, hey, I have a heteroatom in here that doesn't fall into the usual carbon, nitrogen, hydrogen, oxygen category. Your mass spectrum would be talking to you, and you could be listening to it and say, and reading the mass spectrum. Sulfur is another one with a subtle M plus 2 peak. Sulfur is predominantly S32, but we also have a little bit of S33 and some S34. The ratio is 100 to 0.78 to 4.40. So again, sulfur will be whispering in your ear, hey, look, I'm here. There's something interesting about this mass spectrum. The ones that will be shouting in your ear are chlorine and bromine. Chlorine is predominantly chlorine 35, but there's also some chlorine 37 present. They're present in about a 3-to-1 ratio, about 100 to 32.5. So chlorine's going to be shouting in your ear with a strong M plus 2 peak that you have an isotope present. Bromine also shouts in your ear. Bromine is almost an equal amount of bromine 79 and bromine 81. also reminding us which elements exist as single isotopomers, lest we be surprised or simply not know. Fluorine 19 exists as a single isotope. Fluorine 18 is sometimes used in imaging studies. It's radioactive. There is no other stable isotope. Phosphorus 31 is another one that has only a single isotope. And again, while phosphorus 32 and 33 sometimes get used in radio labeling studies, they're not stable or found in the in nature. And iodine also exists as a single isotope. So armed with this knowledge and a little bit of cleverness, you actually can start to read some simple mass spectra. So as I said, sulfur and silicon have small but noticeable M plus 2 peaks. So if I sketch out the following EI mass spectrum, you should actually be able to infer the compound. This particular EI mass spec that I'm sketching has a peak at 74, a peak at 64, that's 100% relative, and 100, people always talk about the relative intensity, so I'll just sketch the biggest peak as 100. So at 65, we have a peak of 0.9, and at 66, we have a peak of 5.0. So what is this compound? Well, it contains sulfur, which, what sulfur compound is? Somebody, I heard several and it all overlapping. Sulfur dioxide, exactly. So in other words, one can, as I said, with a little bit of cleverness, put some ideas together. All right, chlorine compounds give a very prominent say M to M plus 2 in about a 3-to-1 ratio if you have one chlorine present. So let's try this mass spectrum. This one will be a little bit harder, but I'm quite sure you can get it and understand what's going on. We have a peak at 36, that's 100 in intensity. But we also have a peak at 35 that has a relative intensity of 12. We have a small peak at 37 that has a relative intensity of 4.1. And we have a bigger peak at 38 that has a relative intensity of 33. HCl. Now, what's happening with HCl here, Doug?
I don't think the Cl minus is 35, so it must be HCl. And then, so that.
All right, you're kind of on the right track. Ionizing. This is EI mass spec. So, what's the molecular ion that we see in EI mass spec? What's a? How can I draw a Lewis structure for it?
Radical.
Radical.
Yeah.
so the 35, the 36 isotopomer, or the 36 peak is going to correspond to the Cl35 isotopomer. The 38 peak is going to correspond to the Cl37 isotopomer. Now, what about this small 35 peak and this small 37 peak? Chlorine, no hydrogen. So if you now imagine going to, so what Lewis structure should I draw for this guy? Chlorine, everyone agrees, 7 electrons?
But that should be iron. Yes.
All right. Chlorine with how many electrons is Cl minus?
8
is Cl minus. Chlorine atom?
7.
We're not going to see an atom in the mass spec because it's neutral. So this is chlorine with 6 electrons around it. So it is a chlorine anion. So you lose a hydrogen atom. Hydrogen leaves with one of its electrons. Remember, it's very hot. It's fragmented. It's very hot. It will fragment. And the fragmentation here would be loss of a hydrogen atom. As I said, nothing profound, but it's stuff that we don't think about a whole lot in organic chemistry, and it's worth taking a moment to wrap one's head around it. Bromine compounds give very large M plus 2 peaks. In other words, M to M plus 2 is about 1. The ratio of heights of the peaks is about, I'll say, 1 to 1. So I'm writing a ratio as a ratio for one bromine. So we'll take another example here. So here we have 94 at 100, 95 at 1.1%, in other words, a little guy, 96 at 98%, and 97 at 1.1%. And again, we're talking EI mass spec. So what is it?
Methyl bromide.
So this peak corresponds to the C12 bromine 79 isotopomer. This peak here corresponds to the C13 bromine 79 isotopomer. The peak at 96 corresponds to the bromine 81 isotopomer at C12. And the peak at 97 corresponds to the C13 bromine 89 isotopomer. And bromines give rise to their own set of patterns. They lead to M plus 4, M plus 6 peaks. I'll say etc. just to indicate that the more chlorines and bromines you have, the more isotopomers. If you have 2 chlorines, for example, you'll see an M to M plus 2 to M plus 4 in about a 9 to 6 to 1 ratio. two bromines. And this is where people start to get confused. Now you're going to see an M to M plus 2 to M plus 4 in about 1 to 2 to 1 ratio. And this is where people start to get confused and say, oh, this is my molecular ion here. I'm pointing to the M plus 2 peak. And then they're off and running trying to fit the mass and getting themselves confused. So this is where it's worth keeping your wits about you. By the time you get to 3 bromines, for example, it's very easy to make that mistake. Because now you're going to have M at roughly 1, M plus 2 at roughly 3, M plus 4 at roughly 3, and M plus 6 at roughly 1 as their relative intensities. And again, with other fragmentation, it's very easy to lose sight of things. There's some very simple math that's sometimes referred to as the nitrogen rule. And that is that if you have a neutral molecule and you have an odd number of nitrogens, it's going to have an odd molecular weight. Or to put it in another way, in the EI mass spec, if you have a compound with an odd number of nitrogen, then you're going to have an odd M plus, an odd molecular ion. And that's just, as I said, that's just simple math. All you need to do is look at a few examples to convince yourself. If I take trimethylamine, for example, its molecular weight is 59. If I take, by comparison, triphenylmethane, its molecular weight is 58. If I take tert-butanol, its molecular weight is 74. In other words, the nitrogen-containing molecular ion is odd, but if you have zero nitrogens, an even number of nitrogens, or two nitrogens for that matter, you're always going to have an even molecular ion. There are a couple of cautions that I want to point out here. One is this only applies to molecular ions. In EI mass spec, you often get fragmentation. So, for example, if I did an EI mass spec of tert-butanol, I probably wouldn't even see the molecular ion. I would probably only see it fragment to a tert-butyl carbyl cation. And that's confusing now for two reasons, the first of which is you don't see your molecular ion. The second is that our weight is equal to 74. So that's an even, I'm sorry, is equal to 57. So that's odd. So now you're confused for two reasons. First of all, you're confused because you've misconstrued the molecular weight of your compound as being 57. And second of all, you're confused because you misconstrued it as having one nitrogen. So this doesn't apply to fragments. Now, with soft ionization methods, everything flips around. remember, soft ionization is CI mass spec, where you're protonating in the gas phase. It's electrospray ionization, where you're putting a proton or a sodium atom, sodium ion on your molecule in the liquid phase. It's also MALDI techniques. So in all of these techniques, you're going to get a molecular ion, or what's sometimes referred to, although I think less and less these days, as a quasi-molecular ion, as a protonated species or associated species. Sodium is ubiquitous in glass and everywhere else, and so it's just something that will end up on a molecule, and you're going to end up with an even number for an odd number of nitrogens. So I'll just draw out two examples. If I have this simple peptide here, acetyl, and just for the sake of an example, I've taken acetyl alanyl alanine amide. So now we have a compound with three nitrogens in it. Its molecular weight is 201. But that means M plus H would correspond to 202. And M plus Na would correspond to 224. In other words, we're getting even numbers. The sodium, of course, and the proton are both going to be acting as Lewis or Bronsted acids. In other words, you would picture a proton coordinating to a lone pair on oxygen or nitrogen. You'd picture a sodium coordinating to a lone pair on oxygen or nitrogen. If I make the corresponding compound with two nitrogens, take one last moment to show two real mass spectra. Jason, can you perhaps pass these out for me? Run up the side of the aisle, roughly split them up. There should be enough to have a few extras. This one as well. You don't need to count. Just grab a handful. They'll make their way around. Very, very quick. All right, so the first one is just a molecule. And I just wanted to show you a typical EI mass spectrum. It happens to be a peptidic molecule. And you'll notice the largest peak here is actually N plus Na plus. And then here's your C13 isotopomer. So this is a compound with 39 carbons in it. We also see our M plus H plus and IPC13 isotopomer. And you'll notice by the time you're getting up to 39 carbons, you are seeing a little bit of molecules with two C13s, or in this case, maybe, well, probably just two C13s. This would be a very typical mass spectrum. Fragmentation can occur by carbocationic processes. So, for example, cleavage of this bond here to give rise to an acylium ion. I'll just write et cetera for the rest of the molecule. Gives rise to that peak over there. So this looks very much like what you'd expect for carbocationic or cationic processes. But again, normal fragmentation would be characteristic of the EI mass spec. Last example I'm going to give is a very big molecule. This was one that just happened in our group meeting last night, and I thought, I really want to show this to you folks. So this is a compound with C168, H208, Br2, N38, O42, S2. And when you're dealing with such big molecules, you're often flying as a polycation. So this particular compound is M plus 3H, 3 plus. And so when I plug in and I calculate, I get that the exact mass for M plus 3H, 3 plus, is 3715 point, it happens to be 3 over here, plus 3, and that means our mass to charge ratio is going to be this divided by 3 is our mass to charge ratio that you would expect for the first line in the cluster. And you'll notice that's right over here. So that number works out to 1239.2, this number here. And that actually 1239.4, which within the limits of experimental error matches up to that first peak. And this whole cluster then corresponds to the isotopic patterns you'd expect for two bromines, two sulfurs, and a bunch of carbons in the molecule. So main point though, our spacing is corresponding to 3/10 of the mass unit because we have a mass to charge ratio of 3. We have 3 charges on the molecule, I should be saying. And we're seeing a cluster where the very first one is our M plus, is our molecular ion, and then we go on out from there for all the rest of the compounds. All right, well, we'll move to EI mass spec when we pick up on Friday.